Welcome to another edition of RCE. Again, this is Brock Palen. We've been away for a while, the holidays and such, and being gone with SCE, we're all really busy, but we're back.
Took us a while, but we're here. Yeah, we're back. It's the end of January, but, you know, it's all good. We were looking for an extra special set of guests.
Yes. Right? Yes. That's Jeff Squyres again from Cisco Systems and OpenMPI. Jeff's a very famous dude. And also, again, you can find us online at rce-cast.com. You can find old shows there because iTunes only shows the last few. There's also an RSS feed and an iTunes podcast feed over in the side, so you can subscribe with your tool of choice.
Yep, and mandatory mention of my own blog over there. I think it's linked to from rcecast.com, and I felt good because I got linked to from inside HPC this week, so that was pretty cool. It always makes the corporate overlords happy. But let's talk about what we've got today, because this is an RCE cast first.
Yes, we have three guests today, I think, and they're all from different places, but they're all working on the same collaborative project. That's why they're so many different places. It is ITAPS, which they will tell us what that means, but we have three different guests. We have Mark Shepard, we have Tim Tautges, and Carl Ollivier-Gooch. So, guys, welcome to the show. Why don't you take a moment and introduce yourselves?
Okay, this is Mark Shepard. I am the Johnson Professor of Engineering and Director of the Scientific Computation Research at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, involved with the ITAPS project in terms of providing primarily tools for supporting adaptive simulation technologies.
Hi, guys. I'm Tim Tautges. I'm a computational scientist in the Mathematics and Computer Science Division at Argonne National Lab. But with a twist, I'm also an adjunct professor of engineering physics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I telecommute from here.
I'm Carl Ollivier-Gooch. I'm a professor in mechanical engineering at the University of British Columbia.
Okay, so ITAPS is actually an acronym, so could one of you explain what that is?
So the acronym for this incarnation of ITAPS stands for Interoperable Tools for Advanced Petascale Simulations. I call that this incarnation of it because we had a previous incarnation in our first 5 years, which was TSTT for Terascale Simulation Tools and Technologies. So presumably the next one will have to come up with an acronym that has an X in it.
I think the only question on the next one is it exascale, or do we say, well, we got to stop just using these numbers and we'll just say extreme? That seems to be the current discussion.
That's a really good idea.
That'll get us the X, and we can use it for exascale, and then we can keep using it after that and not have to keep changing the acronym.
Right.
Or you could just go to like the Cyrillic alphabet, and then nobody will know what you mean anyway.
Perfect.
That was actually a question I thought of. We had petascale machines. What was next? But okay, we'll get to that. So, what is the goal of ITAPS? Like, it's a collaboration. What is the actual end goal of the project?
Well, the vision is that people who write application software in scientific computing generally know a lot about the physics, generally would prefer not to have to know about how do you deal with unstructured mesh databases, or how do you deal with making sure that your metadata about your problem gets stored and is saved and reloaded properly and so on. And so we're trying to provide that infrastructure and provide it in a way that doesn't tie you down to a particular implementation, which makes it so that you can, you know, switch to something else that happens to do better for your application, for example. And also do it in a way that makes it so that none of the infrastructure things are the bottleneck issues for your massively parallel simulation.
Yeah, so whenever you're dealing with mesh data, meshes and algorithms that work with mesh, usually it's just a matter of time before something breaks, either because the algorithm you were trying was implemented with a specific application in mind, or your particular data is different from what the algorithm was originally designed for. So being able to trade out different algorithms, maybe that do similar things but in different ways, improves the chances that you'll actually be able to string together the algorithms that you need to get the job done. And so that interoperability is really key to getting these things done.
Right. Just a follow-up on Tim's comment also. The fact that we're doing implementations of these things within groups that have been doing these things for many, many years, we also have implementations that don't make some of the same mistakes that others would make if they were doing it themselves, because we made that mistake 20 years ago or whatever, and have learned from it and have capabilities that account for those things.
Ah, sounds pretty much like the same rationale that we have for MPI, actually, since that is kind of my purview there. So let me clarify on that. So are we talking about middleware here? These are functions that applications will call from C or Fortran or whatever?
They're actually so ITAPS deals at multiple levels. So primarily, we advertise ourselves first as a common API for accessing mesh and data associated with the mesh. But in the use of that API, there are multiple uses. So I'll go over one use, and the other guys can talk about the others. Each of us may have an implementation of that API, so that an application wanting to talk to mesh data can talk through that API or that functional interface and use either my implementation of it or somebody else's implementation of it.
So another attractive feature here is that if you've got some piece of code that works perfectly well and you've got your own mesh database that you're perfectly happy with, you don't want to have to rewrite all of that to use somebody's algorithm for, say, mesh adaptation. In fact, that's probably the last thing you want to do. So having the standard API makes it so that you can look up in the documentation for, say, the adaptation service you want to use, oh, it requires the following 20 functions from this API. You implement those functions on top of your mesh database, and away you go, without having to change your data structures and or change the way that the algorithm interacts with data structures.
Okay, so if ITAPS is all for... you implement these functions so that everybody can access data and share things interactively. How is this different than using a common like data storage library like HDF or CDF or XDMF, who we've had on this show before?
Well, I think it's largely a matter of a difference between live data in memory and data stored on disk. HDF5 will give you a lovely hierarchical storage structure for whatever data you want to stuff into it. And that's great. But when you want to use that data live in your simulation, the fact that it came out of an HDF5 file is really not relevant at that stage.
Well, a simplistic way of looking at sort of the difference is that The ITAPS APIs answer questions you might ask about the data. So if you want to know something, you want to know a relationship, it answers the question on the relationship as opposed to just dumping a bunch of data on you.
Yeah, and like Carl said, we're definitely geared towards providing access to data that's in memory. So like in the context of a parallel simulation, if an application needs to get information about a mesh, especially if we're talking about petascale or exascale systems, there's not the option to go down to disk and get it and then pull it back. You just don't have time for that. So it's really an in-memory API.
So before you mentioned somebody talking about, you know, they wanted to implement a new particular functionality and they only had to look up, say, you know, 20 APIs and implement those. Is the ITAPS API logically divided into groups, or how does that work?
Yeah, so we actually have four different APIs for different kind of classifications of mesh of data. So one of the APIs is called iMesh. It's for accessing finite element or unstructured mesh data. Another one is iGeom for accessing geometry, think CAD data. Another one is for accessing field data, which is, you know, field data is data that has semantics and operations on the data. And then finally, the fourth one is relations that allows you to relate things between any of those other three interfaces. So we separate them into those chunks to allow an application to pick up any one of the chunks without having to get the other three. So that's those are the interfaces. And then ITAPS also deals at higher levels. We describe services that interact with those interfaces. And then above that, we think about integrated higher level applications that may use multiple services along with those interfaces.
And all of these services are in-memory kinds of services? You're not necessarily talking about stable storage or things like that?
Yeah, typically they're in-memory, although many of the implementations of say, the mesh interface will have the ability to save out to a file, you know, stored in HDF5 or some other type of format like that.
Okay, so they're all in memory. I have a question here then. Is the distinction in memory, like you would, are these libraries you all link together and you have one application, or is this actually for handing off between multiple applications so that data stays in memory because it takes too long to go to disk on these huge systems? Like I'd run my simulation, it would stop and wait for a connection from a post-processor visualizer program, or would it leave it in like a shared memory region? Like how is this passing actually going back and forth, and at what level is it at?
So what you've just described there is an interesting application that no one's tried to write yet. In fact, we're thinking in terms at this point in terms of the simulation code that links in a number of ITAPS libraries and does its thing and then writes the data that needs to be written and it's done. In principle, there's nothing that prevents one, I suppose, from having the sort of shared memory handoff from one piece of code to another, but I don't think anyone's tried to write anything like that yet.
I'll give an example of that type of thing. As was explained earlier, we provide the ability to support a lot of operations that get carried out in a mesh that the people that write the physics codes don't want to deal with. One of those is to make the mesh better during the analysis process so you get better solutions. So in that interaction, there's a mesh to start off with. The analysis program does some analysis of that. We have to look at those results. We change the mesh. We give it back to the analysis. Now, initially, they don't want to touch their analysis program, so we use all the ITAPS APIs basically to construct their files and do that. But then they discover that when we're doing that on parallel computers, all this file I/O is a real killer. So then they say, well, we're interested in doing more. And we say, well, this was all done through an API. So instead of having this API just be a file writer and reader, constructing a file writer and reader, tell us a little bit about your data structures, and we'll use the API to extract information from your data structures and put information back into them so that they can run together. And basically have those different applications and their analysis application and our meshing services all running one after the other and handing off the data without having to go through files. And we have some experience of that. That's limited, but that is part of the goal of being able to one of the goals of doing these things.
Yeah, so in fact, we're even going in that direction in terms of multi-physics coupled analysis. If you look right. at those if you look at those types of applications, you quickly realize that the data backplane that connects the various types of physics being coupled together is usually the mesh and data associated with the mesh, at least for simulations that solve systems of PDEs. So when you realize that, you realize that your in-memory mesh representation and the field data that lives on the mesh is actually that data backplane that connects the various physics together. So we're packaging, you know, some services that involve transferring solutions between meshes on that's some of the stuff that I do with my implementation, and we're implementing coupled nuclear reactor simulation codes that talk through that and pass the data through the mesh like that.
So I'm kind of fascinated with the idea of the composability of what you're talking about here. You know, having multiple providers provide, say, different algorithms for similar or the same operations. How do you actually implement that? Is that are we talking plugins or components, or are they just different libraries that use the same API? And so I just use the standard -L kind of linking stuff in my make file, or how does that go?
Carl?
So, okay, I'll take that. So as far as hooking yourself up to one of the existing implementations, it's pretty much a plug and play thing at the makefile level. And in fact, we've got some makefile include stuff defined to make that even easier from the application point of view. You know, that's pretty much true at the implementation level. For services, at this point, our focus there is more on providing services that use the API so that people can take advantage of those services. Those tend not to have multiple implementations, because we'd rather spend our effort on creating more services rather than more copies of the same service. You know, eventually, you know, would it be nice to have, say, multiple mesh adaptation schemes available? Sure, because all of those have their own strengths and weaknesses. But we haven't gotten to that point yet in terms of that breadth of support.
So I have a question. So you're talking about these common interfaces and stuff. Has anybody ever made a... Well, first off, you're talking about you had make files. You have actual libraries and code that I can download from your website and use them. Like, you've already defined a lot of these. Okay.
Yep.
So has anybody, like, say, a vendor specific for their system that, say, doesn't support certain functionality, like runs a stripped down OS, made an ITAPS, like, API matching system so that someone can move their code over there, use ITAPS, but you guys don't actually support their system?
No, these APIs and implementations are still pretty high level in terms of simulation codes. So to compare to MPI, for example, there isn't that as close a link with vendors that are selling things. Although very recently, there is a commercial software vendor that's been involved, who themselves market and develop libraries that provide mesh and mesh-based services. And Mark's connected with that outfit, and so there's some connection there.
Right. You know, so backing up a little, so, you know, for, as Tim said, the things we're doing are at a higher level and also targeted to a much narrower community, if you will. It's higher level from the standpoint, for example, our parallel mesh, well, that uses MPI. It's on top of MPI. And in terms of the point Tim was making about the commercial vendors, so they're in the CAE world, the computational engineering world, the computer-aided engineering world, there's historically software was very much, you know, packaged in a specific way, which was not very amenable for expansion or plug-and-play type of interactions. But in recent years, some smaller, newer companies have started to develop more component-based types of tools in that area. So this particular company, its name is Symmetrics, that is we're interacting with, is actually has very similar sets of tools and services to some of the ones that we're doing, and they have some additional ones. So they're creating an ITAPS interface to their tools and technologies, so that they now the set of services and tools that are available and things that can be supported for various applications, and at this point primarily in the DOE, can be supported not only with specifically ITAPS developed services, but with services that those guys have been developing.
So I think if you're looking for analogies, the one that probably matches best to us and that your listeners are going to be familiar with are in the area of solvers for systems of equations. So, you know, a number of open source solver projects have been developed, particularly in DOE, over the last decade, and have really transformed how people do large-scale parallel computing. And those are PETSI and Trilinos, and there are a few others. And so we're shooting for trying to do the same thing with mesh and mesh-related data. We're about 10 years behind in the solver people, but we think we're going in a fairly similar direction.
Okay, so then a question about the model that applications write to. So in a PETSI-like kind of way, do these rocket scientists and whatnot, do they still think in a serial model? You know, they call a magic ITAPS function that is parallel behind the scenes and scales out really nicely, and they just get their answer much faster, and they're able to use much bigger data sets than they were able to before? Or are they still programming in a parallel model, and these are just better implementations of on a single machine kinds of algorithms?
Yeah, so I think that's the answer to that may be multiple choice, in the sense that it depends on what level you're writing things at. If you've got somebody who's writing a service that uses our parallel mesh API, they're going to have to be aware that they're programming in a parallel environment, because the API is one way to characterize it is that it is written in a way to make it so that the things you want to do are all possible, but all the things you want to do are not already in existence in the API. So you're going to have to keep track of, oh yeah, so here's some data that's near the boundary between two processors in my parallel simulation, and I have to do something special here. Now, at a higher level than that, if you say, well, I want to combine three different mesh improvement services to make my mesh even better, say, you know, at that level, if those services are written properly, of course, you don't have to be parallel aware at all. You can just say, improve my mesh, and that will work regardless of whether you're serial or parallel.
So how much external software do you guys rely on? Do you use any third-party libraries to provide some of your functionality? Or is everything, like 99% of what you've written, is yours?
I think it depends on the particular implementation or service you're talking about. So one thing that's common to all the implementations of these APIs, at least, is that we all use an auto tools based build process. But then the individual implementations will do various things. So, for example, the Moab library that I develop interacts, saves its data to an HDF5 based file, and also has readers for reading that CDF based data. And I've connected VizTools to this data through things like VTK and some of the higher level Viz packages that are based on VTK.
Our parallel structures, I think all our parallel implementations are using MPI also.
Yeah. There's a certain level beyond which you can't get away from using outside libraries, of course, because if you don't, then you're reinventing wheels that other people were better qualified to build anyway.
So some of the more interesting things that are really just now kind of coming into the fore are how do you connect, you know, the data that you get on a mesh with some of the other peer libraries that these large simulation codes tend to use, like how do we take the geometric look at the data that we get from a mesh and translate that to a vector matrix view of the data that a solver is going to communicate in terms of? And when you've answered that question, usually the next one that comes up is, how are you going to do preconditioning of your system, which often will tie back to the geometry and the mesh part of the problem. So it's starting to get more interesting seeing some of these higher level connections start to get made.
All right, so let me go in a slightly different direction here. So, you know, the P in ITAPS is about petascale, but, you know, didn't we already smash the petascale barrier? I mean, why does that matter anymore? Isn't all the current cool work going on in exascale?
So I kind of think of this in terms of blazing a path through the wilderness. So, you know, the codes that have been there, done that with petascale and are going towards exascale, they're the ones that are blazing that path. But we're about interoperability. And when you're talking about interoperability, you're implying that there are multiple pieces or multiple tools that you have a choice of. So maybe we're not blazing the first ones to blaze the path there, but we're the next ones up trying to make it more of an everyday occurrence to be using these kinds of systems. So when you're talking about interoperability, you know, the problem has not been solved at the petascale yet, and some would argue even the terascale. So for codes that are wanting to get quickly up to speed in the terascale or petascale class machines, that's really where our sweet spot is, or one of them is. And then we're also, among us, are ones that are in that part of the community that's blazing a path towards the exascale as well.
Right. Just to follow up and a little bit more on that. Well, first, the funny part of it, it's petascale because at the time that, you know, this proposal was written for this 5-year project, of which we're in the fifth year of, that was the target, was petascale. So that was the title. Our next title will be extreme scale, most likely. That way we don't have to worry about whether it's exa or not. It'll be whatever's, it could be the exa or what's after that. More realistically, as Tim was indicating, there's the trailblazers with respect to simply performance. There's the fixation on the top 500, which is LINPACK. Well, relative to the types of operations we have to carry out and the type of data we're working with, doing LINPACK stuff is a triviality. We're dealing with a lot more complex unstructured data. By the same token, we are involved with pushing these things. The tools that we are developing, we have been running on machines such as, the 288,000 core machine at Eugene. We've run these tools on in conjunction with CFD codes that have scaled on that machine. So we are involved with running stuff on the very largest machines. At the same token, though, as Tim emphasized, what we will insist on is that we're doing things that will be interoperable and deal with the challenges of interoperability, and we will get to the size of stuff as we get to there, as opposed to worry about, well, let's just do something big, however limited it is, and then we'll come back and add more capability. We insist on the capability, and we'll go to the size as we proceed.
So if I could paraphrase your answers there, so it's more about bringing the petascale to those who need it, not just the 7 machines that happen to be over the 1 petaflop mark or however many there are. It's more about making that available and the commoditization of petascale, for, I guess, is one way of
But it's not so much it's machines, it's the applications. It's doing the work that people really need, as opposed to, for example, solving a problem on a completely uniform grid on a cube, which is going to be much easier to get all the floating point performance on, because you have beautiful structure in all directions.
So, Jeff, one way to push Tim's analogy perhaps a little too far is, you've got the people who are you know, blazing the trail through the wilderness, and you know, we're working with those people as that's appropriate. But after somebody's blazed a trail through the wilderness, hey, this is North America. Somebody's got to come through and build the superhighway with the nice rest stops. That's us.
So another thing to keep in mind is that you know, the codes that are running at scale are the physics analysis codes. But oftentimes, the data that they're working on has been generated or processed or interacted with on smaller systems. And so oftentimes, these large calculations are going to break down at the stage where you're trying to come up with a complex geometric model to simulate. And that's not done at the petascale. That's done interactively at a high-powered workstation. And so the tools that we're developing kind of span the spectrum from the workstation class codes that are you're using to build your model all the way up to the petascale and exascale codes that are actually consuming that mesh. So in a sense, that's why we justify being 10 years behind the solver people, is that, you know, we have a much wider scope in a sense.
So for actually using ITAPS, what's it written in?
Well, the API is a C API that's been designed so that it will be easily compatible with Fortran, and you know, that has some implications for how you pass arguments. Of course, the existing implementations down underneath those wrappers are all working in C++.
So before we started recording, we were chatting a little bit and getting everybody's name down and things like that. And you mentioned that all three of you were on a con call earlier today already. So what is the ongoing work that you guys do in ITAPS? Are you still designing new APIs, or are you collaborating on semantics or working together on software implementations?
We're in the process of kind of working some wrinkles out of one of the higher level APIs, the IREL, the relations interface, as well as we're moving towards, I think at the end of February, a 1.2 release, which is basically a clearer specification of what the interface is, as well as all ready to go implementations of the interface. And some services that work with the interface.
Another thing that we're working on at this point is we've got a what we think is a reasonably complete design for a field interface, so that you can interact with your solution field data in through a common API. That's to the point where those of us who are working mostly on that have gotten to the point where we've decided that, well, we could talk about this more if we wanted to, but we're fundamentally unlikely to learn much more about which parts of this are good and which parts of this are bad until we start writing some code. So we're at the point of putting together a sample implementation or two of that and learn from that and figure out how to improve that API before we release it on the wider world.
So in other words, the answer to your question is yes, we're doing all the above, because there's different levels of maturity of some of the different parts.
So I've got a user question. How hard is it to use ITAPS if you have an existing application? Can you take just bits, or do you have to take the whole thing? Or is it really hard to kind of drop in on top of your code, and you really need to build something from scratch when you're using it?
So that's one of the things that that we really care about. And so the answer is you can dip a toe in the water and interact with iMesh in particular at a very crude level, or just a simple interaction with the library. So, for example, one of the things that we've done several times is you have an analysis code, you want to pick up a mesh through the iMesh API because that might allow you to grab mesh data that was generated somewhere else that you don't currently interface with. So in the code, that looks like instantiating the API, telling it to read a file with this file name, and then calling an API function to get the mesh vertices and to get the mesh elements of the particular type you're interested in. So that's a real easy way to get into using it, is just to use it basically as a file importer. And then there are more complicated ways of interacting with the API that, you know, after your first after doing that little toe in the water exercise and verifying that, yeah, I can work with it, then you might want to use it to do some more interesting things.
So a natural follow-on question to that is who is using ITAPS? What users are there that you're aware of? And perhaps even more interesting is, are there people out there who aren't using ITAPS who should be?
A couple different things that are interesting applications. At Argonne, we're putting some of our reactor analysis codes on top of the iMesh API and on top of the Moab component which implements this. So there's a lot of interest in modeling and simulation of nuclear reactors because, frankly, it's very, very difficult to build experiments on anything these days, and on reactors it's even more difficult. So if we can simulate them, then it's not only cheaper but tractable to actually model their behavior. And then a wildly different application that has come up is modeling the dynamics of glaciers, of land-based ice as they flow over the bed. And that's actually quite an important problem in the climate modeling community, because the behavior of land-based glaciers over the next 100 years has the potential of causing meters of sea level rise. So they're using, they're accessing mesh through the iMesh interface and using a mesh-based representation of the underlying bed whose topography can be quite varied. Those are a couple of applications I'm involved with.
Applications that our tools are being used, our ITAPS tools are being used with, include fusion plasma modeling, modeling electromagnetics and linear accelerators, active flow control applications, and a two-phase flow application. And in answer to your question, are there people out there that should be using it that aren't using it? Of course there are. There's tons of them. But we, you know, it's going to take us a little bit more maturity to be able to easily get many more of them, you know, get a large number of them hooked on using these tools, and that's what we're working towards.
One of the things I forgot to mention, too, I'd like to just reinforce about what Mark said. When you first start thinking about interacting with mesh and mesh data, it's fairly intuitive, and a lot of codes decide, well, I'll just write that data structure myself, and then they go and do it. But as you get into some of the more trickier aspects of those things, like how do you deal with a mesh that's tens of millions of elements or hundreds of millions of elements, or how do you adapt the mesh, and how do you deal with a data structure that can be changing like that? Those kinds of problems can be kind of a black hole of implementation. And there are lots of groups that have dealt with that in very challenging environments, and many of those groups are involved in the ITAPS collaboration. So basically, anybody who's thinking that they need to implement their own mesh data structure should really think about exploring some of the ITAPS technologies to provide that level of service.
So who all's participating in this? I mean, each of you guys are from a different facility and different backgrounds and different use cases. How many different people are involved with this, kind of giving their input on what sort of functionality should be available?
trying to think how many individuals there are. I know in terms of organizations, we've got people from Lawrence Livermore, from Sandia, from Argonne, from Brookhaven, from Oak Ridge, so five of the DOE labs. From universities, we've got RPI, we've got Stony Brook, we've got Wisconsin, we've got UBC, and University of Colorado. And now Mark and Tim can tell me who I forgot.
Oh, and we also have a software house that is providing us some inputs also.
Right, Symmetrics.
And PNNL.
Yes,
right.
PNNL.
Pacific Northwest. Yeah, so six national labs and four or five universities. It's a pretty large collaboration.
So just out of curiosity, do you guys share the code or do you have your own software repositories that are, you know, you're collaborating mostly on the APIs, not necessarily the implementations?
Well, all of us on this call came in with our own mesh database implementations that were pretty mature. And so, you know, we've implemented the APIs on top of the mesh database that we've got. You know, it's fair to say that the service software that's in existence at this point anyway is also largely, we've got this service, we'll make it work with the API kind of thing. So, you know, I think it's more a collaboration in the sense of sharing ideas and making sure that we end up with an approach that works for a variety of different ways of doing things, rather than a collaboration in the extreme programming sense of sitting down with somebody else and writing code. That would be at the far end of the scale.
So that said, we do have a common repository for the header files that define the interface, as well as for unit tests. There's a single implementation of a unit test or a compliance test that's run against all the implementations. And that stuff, I think by and large, except for the commercial software vendor, most of the other efforts are open source at some level, and you can get access to source code primarily from the individual institutions' software repositories. But that's all linked from the ITAPS website, and the unit test stuff is accessible from there as well.
So let me ask you just a pure curiosity question that I ask a lot of our guests. What do you guys use for software version control, and why?
We use Subversion for version control. I guess why, I think there are probably those among us who feel fairly strongly about it having to be Subversion and not Git or Mercurial, while others probably don't care all that much.
Yeah, for myself, my research group switched from CVS to SVN a number of years ago because we needed the ability to access the repository through the wire from other machines. And since then, basically we've stuck with Subversion because of inertia. There's not been, to my mind, a really compelling reason to switch to something else, and so, you know, we've never done it. It does the things we need.
I imagine you encountered the equivalent of the holy wars on what kind of software repository a given thing should be in.
yes, we do. I am asking purely out of curiosity because I enjoy the diversity of answers that we get to that question. I, of course, have my own opinions, but that's not what I'm asking here.
Yeah, but I will say, just yesterday, as a matter of fact, and during a team exercise I was having, one of the guys that works for me told me that in the time it took to check out one of the components he needed to work with that's in a Git-based repository. He was able to build the three different implementations of the three different interfaces that we work on in the time it took to get the source code for the other thing. So
I'm a little opinionated about that. They shall surely inspire some fire by some of our listeners. But that's...
Yeah. The good news is you guys will get the hate mail and not us.
That's right. Because we don't know who that was who was speaking.
Right. Just forward it to this guy over some.
Yes.
So that said...
I won't tell you who it was that told me that. How's that?
So that said, what's the website and contact information for people who are interested in ITAPS and so they can send you flame messages?
Brock, what's your email?
All right, let's rephrase the question. How does somebody get involved in ITAPS? How do they find out about your APIs and the documentation and the software and all that kind of stuff?
Yeah, so you can get to us by basically browsing over to the website, www.itaps.org. That's ITAPS.org. And that'll have the coordinates of how to send us email as well.
Mark, Tim, Carl, thanks again for your time. This has been great. The show will be up soon, and I will send it to you so you can send it wherever you need. So thank you very much for your time.
Appreciate your time, gentlemen.
Thank you, guys. Good work.
Bye now. Yeah.